Welcome back to Wild Speculations. I'm Daniel.
I'm Scott.
This week, tonight, we talk about Critical Role Campaign 2, Episode 123, Fairweather Faith.
Yes.
Good episode.
Great episode.
Long episode.
Very long, yes.
And I think most of our predictions were correct.
Yeah, I believe so. Yeah.
In the sense of the timing of everything.
Yeah, as far as timing. Did not call Galadon coming. Though...
Well, we talked about them meeting Galadon. And I said
back when we were saying they were going north before they even decided to go north, we said they were going to run into Galadon again. We just didn't call it as a random encounter on the way.
Yeah.
So we'll go half credit for that one.
Yeah. We have the recap, and Matt basically sets out again that we are picking up. Caleb and Beau just woke up, and then the investigation into the hell is in his eyes, the hell's going on.
Can you rub it out?
Yes.
You know, we try several different methods. We try rubbing it off. We try...
Acid.
Acid. We try greater restoration. Discuss amputation. Discuss divine intervention. Do you think there's a way to remove the eyes? And if so, what do you think it is?
They kill the Cognosa.
Okay.
They go to the Astral Sea, and they destroy the section of that sea.
Kill the head vampire, all the other...
Yep. Okay. I was so upset at one point in the beginning of the episode that I almost got on Twitter and said something about it. And it was when they were talking about, does Bo have a glove that she can wear? And she's describing all of the things that she does on her hands for the day. And Matt said, she's like, you should smell them, they stink. And Matt says, smell the glove. It's a great album. Nothing. I was just like, what? Disrespect on the Spinal Tap. so upset. But
yeah,
I've been there. Joke goes flat. Nothing you can do.
And I do have to give credit to Sam for the most Sam answer ever. Matt says, you might want to think about having, you know, bass if you're going to play with acid. Oh, I'll get that next campaign.
So good. So good. I was also happy with Ashley's role.
Yes.
And I believe an 11 is what Travis rolled when Avantika.
Well, he rolled an 11 and then an 8 as well.
Yeah.
So I think it's not all...
No, he does change them up. As they encounter those things... He takes them out.
Right, but I don't think like all 8 are like Avantika and Galadon. I think it might be like random encounters as well. I don't think it's all things from the past.
No, I think, I agree. I think
just number 8 is. And
one of them
gets switched out.
One of them is the wolf.
Mm-hmm. The Yetis.
One of them's the Rimuraz.
Mm-hmm.
Or perhaps 2 are the Rimuraz, because Matt made a note that this thing is after them now.
Yeah. Well, it could be one's the Rimuraz, and now it's also in the rotation for number 8.
Yeah.
Because I think the eight rotation is Avantika,
specific
people hunting them.
Yeah. they didn't, that wasn't asked on Talks when Matt was there.
No.
So.
But I think I remember him, you know.
Well, he mentioned that he takes them out.
Yeah.
When they come up and it doesn't make sense for it to just remain, he takes them out and replaces it with something else.
Yeah.
So we know that's the case. As Matt's putting the board out and he puts the Dragon Mini on the table.
Yeah.
They mention this is Vorrigal level stuff. And they're like, yeah, we don't have a Garistra with us. And we don't have a demon.
Yeah, and it was like, yeah, you do.
They do have a fiend.
you do.
Yeah.
If Vor didn't stop summoning it to do smites.
Well, no, Lucian.
Oh, yeah, okay.
And Lucian, arguably, might be tougher than the Garistra. Because he's got legendary resistance and actions.
Yeah.
Where the Garistra is just bang, 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 and a sack of hit points.
Yeah.
And really, I think they summoned that thing so that the White Dragon would kill it, and then they could finish off the White Dragon. I think that was the original plan. Or they would be happy to finish whoever didn't die first. I think that was,
right.
If memory serves. Because the Garistra had the... I don't even remember what it was. One of the vestiges was stuck in it.
Yeah.
That they were collecting. But yeah. Big change in some combat actions. And like another great example of my argument that combat is role play.
Yeah.
Because some huge things happened in that fight with Galadon. Role-playing wise.
Mm-hmm.
Caduceus, first spell cast, protection from energy.
Yep.
He protects himself. And then his next spell is harm.
Yeah.
Not a heal spell. And mm-hmm. Jester casts a heal spell.
Yeah.
Yasha throws her sword again. So I'm waiting for her to get some javelins. Not that she can get them where they're at now, but...
Right.
She really needs those javelins. And Ford, Travis really, shows off Ford's build in the Galadon fight. Hexblade cursed,
yep.
Armor of Hexes, crit, dump the smite.
Mm-hmm.
Because he did 106 points?
Yep. 106, yeah.
And then Veth had a turn where she did 85, I think.
Somewhere in there. I like the opening with Jester and Bo working in tandem.
Mm.
Mentioned Dorian on Back of the Dragon. That's very much a style of play I approve of.
Yeah, and well, so we talked last week about how whatever encounter they had, they should conserve their high-level spells.
Yep.
We've also said they probably wouldn't.
Yep.
and they did not.
Well, let's be fair. It's an ancient black or ancient white dragon.
I don't know. Seeing the damage that Ford and Veth are putting out on the Tomb Takers, I don't think I would have used...
I probably would have... Well, I'm a lot more conservative with my spell slots. I do a lot more reckless things, such as getting on the back of a dragon, which I've done multiple times.
Yeah.
But I do tend to conserve my higher level slots.
Yeah.
A lot.
Well, especially when you're so close to where you know you're going to be going to have to throw down.
You know, that's the question that I had is, how many consecutive interrupted long rests are they going to have before they start conserving those high-level things at the Because this is what, like 3 or 4 in a row?
How many long rests are left in the campaign? And then add more to that.
So you're saying somewhere around the midpoint of campaign 5?
I think the early teens of campaign 3.
Okay.
When they're back to level 3 and they've only got the 4 slots. Then it's, I'm not going to cast it. Oh, I'll cast a cantrip. Like the big thing for me, talking about spell usage,
mm-hmm.
resource management, the biggest waste was Caleb casting Wall of Fire when Jester was gonna use Sending.
Yeah.
Do you think, because I was thinking about this. He was close enough for Caduceus to get a beat on him. Why wouldn't they just use Message? At least try it. It's a cantrip.
Yeah.
If he's too far for it, then he's too far. But, like, that was the biggest thing for me.
Yeah.
Is because they used Wall of Fire, 2 sendings, and then Caleb used, of course, his 7th level spell to summon the mansion.
Yeah.
And then Caduceus and Jester both use commune. So.
Yeah.
Chasing the Tomb Takers down, they were down basically, I think, almost everything above 4th level.
Yeah, I think so.
Greater Restoration.
Yeah. That's going to come back to bite him.
I am deathly afraid of that. Because that 500 gold piece diamond is for Ray's dead. That's why they bought it.
Yep.
She says, oh, I've got a lot of diamonds. But not that diamond.
Personally, I would have ground up the residuum.
I would have used the residuum, too. Or maybe one of the... Well, even... I don't know. I'm not sure how many they have. And I think that's why Laura was like, oh, I got a bunch of diamonds.
Yeah. And I know they have a few smaller sized diamonds.
Yeah.
Like in the 50 to 100 range.
Yeah. Because Jester needs it for Insight Greed.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, from acquisitions.
Yeah. So they discover... the bag being stolen. Well, is there anything else we want to talk about for the combat? For the fight with Galadon?
No. I mean, it was pretty rough, especially for Bo being frozen to the dragon, you know. But, I mean, other than, I don't know. You can say they blew their spell slots too quickly, but again, it was an ancient white dragon. So, yeah, that's about it.
Oh, that's what I was, that's what I wanted to talk about with the Greater Restoration. Technically, Matt told them their exhaustion would come in at the end of their long rest.
Yeah.
And he allowed it to negate the
exhaustion.
Yeah, before it actually happened. I don't know if that really matters, but there were a couple things in this episode where I was like iffy on the timing.
I mean,
and that was one of them.
If you want to get real picky, yeah, it matters, and no, it shouldn't have happened. But I think I would be inclined to be like, yeah, okay, I'll, you know, let it slide.
Yeah, because I mean, he did tell them that they knew how much it was going to hurt in the morning.
And more than half of them were still going to have it anyway.
That's fair. So, they discover the bag is stolen.
Yeah.
And Ford said when Otis hid behind him.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that is correct.
Yeah.
And I have a feeling that that was Otis's plan all along. Once they show them where the stone was,
mm-hmm.
That was going to be what was going to happen.
Yep.
And
really what they should have done was move the stone.
Yeah. Put it in Jester's bag.
Yep.
Yeah. I loved Sam's Highlander reference. There can be only one.
Yep.
Sam had a lot of good lines that episode.
Yeah.
Also, point of order, Mage Hand will not pick up a bag of holding.
Nope.
Mage Hand will only pick up 10 pounds, and a bag of holding
is 15.
Yep. So, which I think is interesting and on purpose design.
Yeah.
Because in world, like a wizard, or if your world has them, artificers
mm-hmm.
are aware of the limitation of Mage Hand. So they make sure their bag just above that.
Yep.
Sort of like the people who want to buy stick shift cars for security, for anti-theft purposes. The same kind of thing, I think. So when they do catch up with the Tomb Takers, this is another timing issue.
Yeah.
Command. Command happens on their turn.
Mm-hmm.
They follow it on their next turn. And this is one of those things where they weren't 100% committed to having this be a full-on combat.
Yeah.
And Matt didn't want to make them roll initiative beforehand.
Yeah. It was an out-of-initiative casting, so it gets wonky.
Yeah. Yeah. Exactly. So, yeah. It's... I don't know. But that was the big thing there. We got confirmation that it is an anti-magic field.
Mm-hmm.
We had, as Matt put it, that's some blue magic shit.
Yep, they tapped all the islands there.
Yeah, counterspell, counterspell, counterspell.
Counterspell the counterspell so that the counterspell can counter.
Yeah. So that the original spell can go off. Yeah. Or be stopped.
Yeah. And evidently, well, I don't know. I don't know if we could say that. I was just, my initial thought was that the Tomb Takers held back in the Galadin fight. They're, you know, conserve their resources. But there's a lot of things in the Blood Hunter, like the curses and stuff, that reset on a short rest.
Yeah.
So, and the one spellcaster that Otis is also a short rest. So,
yeah.
It's a lot easier for those guys in Ford, say, to blow through things every fight.
Yeah. Well, arguably, they were also holding back against the Mighty Nine. Unless I am... Well, if I'm right, they might not have been. But if I'm wrong, they definitely were. So, only one of them used a blood curse. Only Lucian.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Well, only two of them for sure can use them.
Lucian and Otis?
Yeah. Cree can't. She's...
Yeah, she's a blood cleric.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I do think Typhel and Norzim...
Zorn.
Zorn. Are multi-class.
Yeah, Typhel's a fighter and blood hunter. I think... I want to say Zorn also is a fighter blood hunter, but I don't think it's the right... mix. It's not the same mix. And Toughnator, yeah, they...
In a minute we'll get into that, because I think they've been historically sticking to the wrong strategy for attacking them, and I'll explain what I mean. Regulations.
Yeah, they really... That would have been great, and it should have happened before. But they were so spent from the Galadon fight and wasting the spells on the trail that they weren't coming with their A game, and they've been polymorphing the ranged hitters.
Yeah.
Which is really the wrong thing to do when you're against the Tomb Takers anyway. And yeah, we'll get more into that.
Yeah, we'll get more into that in a minute.
But Zorin doesn't have three attacks. Typhel does. So Typhel's at least an 11th level fighter.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe higher. But she didn't use a blood curse, so I don't think she's higher than level 1.
Yeah, because you get the blood curses at level 2.
Yeah. And same with Zorin. We didn't see him use a blood curse.
Could Zorin be Ranger Blood Hunter? Because we talked about them probably having a ranger, and that's how they could keep up the speed.
I think he's, yeah, I think so.
That's what where my mind was, that he was the ranger.
Yeah. I think that's accurate. Or he's not a fighter and he's a ranger.
That's
ranger,
I mean,
Blood Hunter.
That's what I mean, Ranger Blood Hunter instead of Fighter Blood Hunter.
Yeah. I hope not, because he could have cast Hunter's Mark. Matt never called it out. So, as far as we know, it didn't happen. But if that were the case, then he could, in theory, have cast Hunter's Mark.
Mm-hmm.
And is going to be able to track them.
Yeah.
We didn't see him use any other spells.
Although, yeah.
Matt hasn't described him as doing the same kind of things that he described Dagon doing for them,
mm-hmm.
to narrate the terrain abilities.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
Hard to say. Or he might be some sort of he might have a Ranger dip, a Bloodhunter dip, and then Fighter.
Yeah.
Where he's only got maybe a first level spell. So he might only be like third level Ranger, or maybe only second level.
Yeah.
He might even not have a Conclave.
Yeah.
All it means is that he's not an 11th level Fighter.
Right.
And Otis, we are now 90%, 95% certain.
He's at least third level in Bloodhunter, and he probably higher, and he went to Order of the Profane Soul, which is the Warlock casting.
Wouldn't it be like around 7th level for the bonus action attack, weapon attack?
Yes. Yes, I believe so.
Okay.
Yeah, the Mystic Frenzy.
Yeah.
And that's specifically Order of the Profane Soul.
Yeah.
It's a subclass feature.
Yeah. We got the Eldritch Blast, and he's got... Is it Eldritch Lure? Is that the name of the invocation? Something like that?
Something like that.
Or you could pull.
Yeah.
I kind of wonder if he also has the push.
That would be funny.
Yeah. So we'll see about that. I have a feeling Otis has Crossbow Expert.
Oh, yeah.
And I can't wait for that to come up.
Yeah.
We saw, and the Mighty Nein were genuinely afraid when Lucien grabs Bo and hits her with his whammy.
Yeah.
Does as much damage as Geladon's ice breath.
Yep.
That's... Like, we start to see how, by himself, he killed.
Yeah.
Vess. Yeah. Because anti-magic field, he grabs her with that, whammies her. Caleb only has 89 hit points, something like that.
Mm-hmm.
And he has a good constitution. So yeah, it's very possible that in one go, he killed her.
Yeah. Yeah, very possible. And psychic damage would be consistent with the way they found the body.
Yeah. Well, interestingly, he also marked Ford. And Matt didn't say that went away.
Yeah.
So... There's also the possibility that if he marks you with that, and then he does it, maybe you have disadvantage on the save.
Yeah.
I mean, there's any number of things. Maybe it does extra damage. It ups the die size. There's any number of things that could happen because of that mark. Which isn't the Bloodhunter thing.
Right.
I don't think. I don't recall any kind of marking ability.
I don't either. It's been a while since I've really dipped into the Bloodhunter class.
So it's possible. Ooh. Maybe it doesn't do anything other than make him immune to that spellcaster's spells. Because he knew that the dragon was fake.
Yeah.
Because he berated his colleagues for falling for it and moved his anti-magic field to make it go away.
Maybe.
And I think I want to give MVP to Sam for this episode.
Hmm.
mainly because well, hypnotic pattern
mm-hmm.
showed them the cone.
Yeah.
And phantasmal force. Thank you. I was blanking on the name of the spell. Phantasmal force. Because I think that's what gave Travis the idea for a major image.
Mm. Yeah. Okay.
And her doing that, he went that way. Which subsequently meant that even though they got slowed, he couldn't catch up enough to knock them out of their polymorphs. So that's why I want to give it to Sam. In addition to his on fire one-liners.
His on fire one-liners, his experimentation with acid, gifting of sex potions. All right, I'm okay with that.
Yeah. I have to say, there was a lot of things in the episode where I was like, you know, I think Jester still has a thing for Caleb.
Yeah, there's a few things that, and I mentioned to you when they check, when Ford says, you know, check his hair, you know, and she goes like this, just like she does, and she says scritch, you know, and she makes noise similar to the scritch, like when she's giving the cats love and stuff.
Yeah.
Which we've seen her do to him before, but not in his human form, only when he's polymorphed.
Yeah. But like, especially combined with 122, when she's joking about when he's the golden retriever presenting himself.
Mm-hmm.
And then in this episode, he takes his coat off and his shirt. And she's like, you're naked. He's like, I have pants on. And then when Veth interrogates her when Ford
kisses her.
Yeah. And she basically just does the, I call that non-committal confirmation. Yeah.
It's like, well, he's showing interest, so sure.
Yeah. Yeah.
Why do you think he did that?
I think...
Was that his way of announcing it to the group, or was that posturing?
I think it was his way of announcing it to the group.
Okay.
I don't think it's posturing. Because I don't think Ford realizes that there's anything between Caleb and Jester. I think any cooling that he sensed from her was simply his own... He's using his own desire to push it aside.
Yeah.
As reason for, okay, she felt, it was just a crush and now she understands that we can't do that. We saw a return again of Toxic Ford, as I like to refer to it as, when.
Or I just say Ford.
When he is poo-pooing her relationship with the Traveler.
Yeah.
The derisive tone he uses when he's like, Artakin?
Yeah. Who are you talking to? The Traveler. And that being the name, like, he's known as his deity. He's like, oh, Artakin?
Yeah.
You know, like, trying to downplay who he is and who he is to her.
Yeah.
You know. And she does take offense to it.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Yeah. Which is why, like, there's all these little... And again, it could just be because I'm looking for it. And I want to see it. I totally acknowledge that fact. But I was just... little tiny things in this episode. I was like, and then Bo and Yasha yelling back and forth about their date.
Yeah.
And Liam trying to give them some cover.
Yeah.
Talking about how there's the Godzilla roar over all of that. But Sam basically grabbing onto that, because when he's talking to when she's talking to Jester, she's like, everyone's finding love. It's great.
Yeah.
And I also love the, someone might swoop in and take him. And my whole thought process, especially watching Laura's reaction to that, it was like, no, someone might swoop in and take her.
Yeah.
But they, I could if I wanted to, but I'm a happily married woman. But we'll see. Only time will tell.
It'll go sideways and Ford will end up with Caleb and they'll start a axis of evil.
Thank you, Tuffner. It's good. I'm not the only one.
I see it. I think I'm more Widow Just than
Forrester,
but I think I see it more just because I like to play the devil's advocate and be like, well, what about this? Than anything.
Yeah.
Because I'm not 100%, I don't think Widow Just is going to happen either. I think that...
Well, like I say, I it is very much for me a... Well, not even Romeo and Juliet, because they actually...
The one who wants it the most is also the biggest obstacle to that happening.
Yes. Yes.
Bren.
Yeah. We got... I think the ultimate...
Good bro sees it too.
The ultimate sign of appreciation from Matt to Taliesin. When he says... Taliesin has the best reactionary fuck yous.
Yeah. I think Taliesin was getting a little frustrated there. There at one point he's like, in a minute I'm just gonna,
Well, especially because I think for Taliesin there's a couple layers there.
Yeah, there's definitely.
Because he was trying to help people all night with their rules, and he was wrong as much as he was right. But then he tried to surrender. And he came after him anyway.
Well, I think another part of it was just like, this started out as his character.
Well.
And he seemed frustrated because he was out of everything for most of that fight.
Yeah.
Because of the end. And he's just like, this is stupid,
Yeah. But to me, it shows how evil Lucien is, number one.
Yeah.
That was very much in line with the Oni.
Yeah.
Lorenzo, who a lot of people connected the portrayal of him to Negan.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I don't care, I'm going to kill you.
Yeah.
Just to prove a point. And I did love, I forget who said, I don't remember if it was, I think it was from the top of the screen. So I think it was Travis, Laura, or Liam who said, how funny is it going to be if you get killed by your former character?
Yeah, that was Liam.
I was like, that would be...
No, that wasn't Liam. It was Sam, and then Liam said, talk about a guy going down on himself.
Oh, yes. Yeah. I don't know if there's anything else to talk about review-wise.
Review-wise, no, not really. But that leads us into one thing. Caduceus and Caleb should not be next to each other the next time they take these people on.
If at all possible, the casters should be 60 feet away from each other.
This setup is a comic book trope. Got the group. You got your group of heroes. You got the group opposing them. You go straight on with what's expected, and they're going to outmatch you. And you've got to do the switch up and switch who's fighting who.
Okay.
For most effect. I think Bo and Yasha need to be on Lucia.
That's also my initial suggestion as well.
I think that... So... And the Ranger bit might be throwing me off because I'm rethinking this, but I think Veth should take on Zorn and Phantasmal force him because he seems like the big brutish one. He seems like the one that's most easily going to be falling for the wisdom save and stuff like that. So I think if she uses that enchantment magic on him,
yeah,
that's going to be her most effective. Ford and Jester could switch off. I'm not sure. I was thinking Ford with Typhel.
Okay.
And Jester with Otis.
Okay.
Have Caduceus and Caleb moving around doing range stuff and picking people off. You could even do that with Jester.
Okay.
If someone else went up against,
So, I have in my sort of thing, it's Bo and Yasha concentrating on Lucian.
Yeah.
And the reason for that is they are the least impacted by the anti-magic cone.
Yep, exactly.
And they're heavy hitters in melee.
Yeah.
The problem is their sentinel abilities don't trigger on each other.
But the only other really melee person is Ford, and he doesn't like to be melee.
Well, except he, in that dragon fight, he showed that he did. So, and if he can armor of hex Lucian, like, it needs, because... And arguably, Bo is wasted against Lucian because she got the fact that he's immune to being stunned.
Arguably, what you want to do is have Bo and Ford on Lucian because Bo can stand 20 feet back and still threaten him with the lightning gloves.
No, she can't. Anti-magic field.
Oh, true.
Nope.
Yeah.
Nope, she's got to be... The melee people have to be right up on
him. Yeah.
So I think Bo is probably better against
Typhel
and Zorin.
Okay.
In my scenario, I've got the Mighty Nein teaming up and then one of them allowing themselves to be teamed up on. Mm. And Bo's the only one that can survive that.
Yeah.
Because she can patient defense. She's got four attacks a turn if she wants. She's got reactions if they miss her.
Yeah.
And she can stun them, and they're not immune to being stunned. So
okay, so Yasha Ford on Lucian.
Yeah, I think that's the sweet spot there. Unless they do a ranged skirmish battle, and I don't think they will.
No,
they should, because that is a weakness that we saw of the Tomb Takers.
Yeah,
Tomb Takers were all melee against that dragon. They had nothing. When the dragon took off...
Otis is the only main range.
Yeah. And I have Caleb and Jester on Otis. Mm. And then Veth I didn't actually put Veth in my notes.
Veth could just be hide, sneak, attack. Move, hide, sneak, attack.
Yeah, and really, that's... Yeah, Veth is going to be picking off people.
Yeah.
But I was thinking about it, and... Because you mentioned most of their abilities come back on a short rest... The Tomb Takers don't have to chase them right now.
No.
They can take their short rest, heal up any of the damage that they took with hit dice, regain their abilities, and then start tracking the Nine.
Yep.
Because they know the Nine are going to want to rest.
Yep.
Yeah, Beth definitely looking for the last hit on Otis, yeah.
Yeah, she will try to gender to that.
But yeah, Caduceus needs to be 60 feet from Lucian. And targeting heals where he can.
Yeah. But he needs to try to be within 30 feet of people, too.
Oh, Toughnator, yes. Yes, 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 yes. She needs to go in. She doesn't care about her life. She needs to be fighting the way Bo is. Because Bo's been putting herself to the hazard.
Yeah.
So, yeah. And... I mean, we all know how I really want Yasha to die.
Just it would so take the sting out of grain on that 500 gold piece diamond.
Yes, it would. Yes, it would.
So, I mean, yes, it that.
Would. Most definitely. But yeah, I think... Their best strategy is for ranged action, but I don't think they're going to get that. Because either the Nine are going to try to loop back to get back to the mansion, or they're going to try to find a spot to try to set up camp.
Yeah.
And...
To pull a dome?
I don't...
If they don't go to the mansion, they're using the dome.
You're probably right.
Now,
they should not.
If they're smart, they do use the dome, but not the way they've been using it. So, in the Arctic, you know, if you're out there, you want to dig in and make a burrow in the snow. Because that's insulation.
Mm. Yeah.
They dig down underneath the snow and then cast the dome. So that the dome is, like, underneath, like, a couple feet of snow.
Yeah.
Cool.
So that's, it's not just a...
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because he has to trigger that ability. He doesn't always have, you know, the... And if he doesn't know it's there...
Well, and they can also... So, Sam has control water.
Mm-hmm.
So he could... reshape the terrain.
Yeah.
The terrain, the snow, to create a false dome.
Mm-hmm.
Over there.
Yeah.
And they dig or whatever over here.
I mean, Ford could do that too.
And he can just... well, Ford can create water. He doesn't have control. Well,
he does as an invocation.
Oh, control water. Well, I don't know if control water will work on snow. Or shape water can.
Okay.
But, I mean, if you wanted to create like a dune sort of feel. But the thing is like, Because control water, he can do a whirlpool, and then he can do a tidal wave. And I don't see how either of those options lead to the dome is not over there.
Yeah.
So that's why I say I don't think that would work.
That's true.
They can't. So here's the problem with trying to get to Essek.
Yeah.
And this gets back to, because I run pretty gritty survival travel when I run games. Technically, they should have had to make a check against exhaustion chasing down the Tomb Takers for a forced march.
Yeah.
And they should have to make another one, and possibly another one. Like, every hour they travel,
even
they should be making.
Even without that, it's not feasible, because it's already been established they're moving towards the northwest side of Aeor, and Essek is on the southeast side.
Well, it's only if
which means the Tomb Takers, if they try to get to Essek, the Tomb Takers will more than likely overtake them by the time they get there. Because they've already established they can move at the speed that the group could with Dagon, and they're not with Dagon, so they're moving at a slower speed. So,
well, with polymorphs, they can get around that. Not that they have that option currently.
Right.
But no, there's no way they can make it to Essek without almost dropping dead first.
Yeah.
It's at least 8 hours, possibly 10 or 12. Maybe double that if Matt is going to charge them the difficult terrain.
Yeah.
Speed penalty. Traveling to Essek is just not an option.
No, not at all.
I
think they send him a message, maybe. Oh no, she doesn't have any sendings left.
No.
So no, they don't even do that.
They sent Dagon that way. And if they can lead the Tomb Takers on a merry chase around Aeor for a period of time, maybe Essek can come in with some Echo Knights.
Yeah.
As a cavalry force. But that assumes a lot, and they definitely can't do that if they're all suffering from exhaustion from having forced march for 3-4 hours.
Yeah.
I don't know if Matt will make them make those checks.
I don't know.
Has
he ever required them to do a forced march check?
Yes.
Okay.
In the mid-20s episodes.
Of this campaign?
Yes.
Okay. I was going to say, I thought I remembered one in campaign one where they spent, like, the extra time to get to a city and he made him make it.
Yeah. But they were traveling to the swamp.
Yeah.
Trafnator, I...
That's... Depends on if they get caught by the Assembly working with them and who in the Assembly catches them working with him.
Yeah.
Because we've already established that he, Essek, has worked with members of the Assembly.
Well, and the thing is the Mighty Nein already, like, the Assembly and the King know that they have high-level contacts in the Dynasty.
Yeah.
Their spy network already knows that the Mighty Nein were meeting with the Bright Queen. And likely they know who their handler was, which was Essek. In fact, I dare say they definitely know, because Ludinus and Essek were talking about it.
Yep.
So
there's at least some faction of the high up of the Senators that knows about it. Now, how much they share with each other, that's questionable.
I think Matt has sort of positioned Ludinus as a potential window on older Caleb.
Yeah.
Because I think Ludinus has done all the kind of shady stuff that Caleb has done and condones in the furtherance of protecting the Empire.
Mm-hmm.
And, like, he doesn't like the fact that Ludinus knows that Trent was doing what he was doing, but, like, I think Ludinus's lackey was up here in the north trying to undermine Vess.
Mm.
Because I think Ludinus has suspicions that she's doing something with the Cognosa.
Okay. Yeah, I can see
and
that.
Ludinus is a very old elf.
Mm-hmm.
So if he doesn't have direct experience, he has direct family knowledge.
Yeah.
Where his father, uncle,
yeah.
mother, aunt, somebody.
It's like, if it's not first-hand knowledge, it's second, maybe third.
Yeah.
But it's not rumor mill from the centuries ago.
Yeah. Of what happened to Eor and the Cognosa.
Yeah.
And,
of course, Trent knows about it because they met with a Volstrucker agent, and that's his little group.
Yeah. Yeah, well, and he knew that they were going up with Vess Tharagna.
Yeah.
Without them telling him.
Yeah.
So, yeah. The thing is, Lucien doesn't have to chase the Mighty Nein. Like, we talked about the difficulty that they would have in finding rest and, you know, recharging their batteries for a fight. The fact is, Lucien doesn't have to chase them. Yeah, they got one of his threshold crests, but he knows where other ones are. But, more importantly, he has their bag of holding.
Yeah.
Now, Ford hasn't been putting a bunch of stuff in there, but there's enough in there that he's going to want it.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, presumably when he took off his Mariner's armor, he put that in the bag of holding.
Yeah.
They've got healing potions in there.
They have Vess in there.
Yeah. So it's, he can be sure that they're going to come for that bag. So he could just get there. He can get to where he's going.
Yeah.
Assume that they will be able to find him. And he can set up all the traps he wants.
Yep.
And just wait. And once his traps have weakened them, he can come in and finish the job.
Yeah.
But one of the reasons why I say the Tomb Takers were taking it easy on them, Lucien didn't use any legendary actions. He used his Blood Maledex twice.
Yeah.
To protect himself. But otherwise, didn't really do much. He hit him with his big whammy,
yeah.
And it recharged, but he didn't do the cuts for the scimitars. He didn't...
No, he did. When he was holding a bow...
Oh, yeah, he used a bonus action.
Against his stomach.
Yeah. The implication being he was going to carve her up.
So he expended the use. He had the right going.
Yeah.
But he never attacked them with it.
Yeah. So, yeah, I think if they can do ranged, which is rough for them, but if they can do it...
Yeah.
Also, Yasha wings... pick these fuckers up and fly them into the sky.
Yeah.
Like, I don't know. Yasha and Veth on Lucien, carrying him into the sky, and Veth just peppering him from below, might be the easy button. if he's willing to dispel her wings and drop and take the fall damage.